This is the fourth video of my video series on running a regression using SPSS. In the previous videos, I discussed how to deal with outliers and how to test for normality and linearity. In this video, I discuss about how to diagnose multicollinearity issues in regression. This should not be confused with serial correlation or autocorrelation. Multicollinearity is a situation where two or more independent variables are correlated with each other. As the term suggests, independent variables need to be independent. If one independent variable is associated with another independent variable, then there is no independence. Multicollinearity makes the regression results less precise and misleading. Each regression coefficient indicates the amount of influence it has on the dependent variable when all the other independent variables are held constant. However, when an independent variable is associated with another independent variable, this interpretation cannot be made because we cannot change the independent variable while holding the other independent variables constant. For example, assume that I have both return on assets and return on equity as independent variables in my regression. We know that it is not usually possible to increase ROA while holding the ROE constant because they are highly correlated with each other. Importantly, when multicollinearity is present, a slightly different model may yield drastically different results. For example, you may get a negative coefficient for a particular independent variable in one model and a positive coefficient for the same independent variable in a slightly different model. One of the easier methods to diagnose multicollinearity is variance inflation factors, or VIF. Usually in regression results, we can see a VIF value for each independent variable. VIF indicates the strength of correlations between independent variables. The VIF value can range from 1 to infinity. If VIF value for a particular independent variable is equal to 1, that independent variable is not correlated with other independent variables. If the VIF value is between 1 and 5, there is a moderate level of multicollinearity. This level of multicollinearity usually does not cause serious problems in the regression results. However, if the VIF values are greater than 5, severe level of multicollinearity is present in the model. In this case, our regression results may be misleading since it is possible that the signs of the coefficients are poorly estimated or the p-values are not reliable. One simple method to fix multicollinearity issues is to drop highly correlated independent variables so that only one is kept. For example, if there are three correlated independent variables, we can keep one and drop the other two from our model. Okay, let's look at an example. For this illustration, I use SPSS version 20 with this test data set. My intention is to assess the effect of firm performance on stock return. This diagram shows my conceptual framework. My dependent variable is stock return. Assume that I use two variables to measure firm performance. First one is profitability, measured using return on assets. And the second one is shareholder return, measured using return on equity. Further, I have leverage and firm size as control variables. Let's run the regression. Move the dependent variable into dependent and my four independent variables into independence. Then click statistics. Select collinearity diagnostics. This will add VIF values into our regression results. Further, I will select Durbin and Watson test as well. Durbin and Watson test is used to test for independence assumption. In an ideal situation, the Durbin and Watson test statistic should be approximately 2. If the Durbin and Watson statistic is less than 1.5 or greater than 2.5, the independence assumption is violated. Independence assumption is frequently violated in time series data. This means if you have collected data over a certain period of time, you need to pay attention to this assumption as well. I have a separate video on diagnosing independence. Anyway, in this video, my primary attention is to this collinearity diagnostic. So after selecting these two checkboxes, click continue. Then click plots to generate histogram and normal probability plots to diagnose for normality in the residuals as well. I discussed about this normality assumption in my second video of this series. So if you need more details, watch it. The link is available in the below description. Then click continue. Then click OK here. Now let's have a look at the regression results. First, we can see that the Durbin and Watson test statistic is almost equal to 2, indicating compliance with independence assumption. And our model is significant too. Also, we can see that out of 4 coefficients, 3 are statistically significant. Even though the coefficient is not significant, just have a look at the coefficient for ROA. It is negative. It is not very practical to have a negative coefficient for ROA in this model. ROA being statistically not significant in predicting stock return also confuses me. Anyway, if we look at our VIF values, we can see 3 very high VIF values. Look at these VIF values for ROA, size and ROE. They are greater than 5, indicating serious multicollinearity in our regression model. The correlation between ROA and ROE is obvious. Here we have a correlation between ROA and size as well. This could be probably due to economies of scale. Anyway, since we have multicollinearity in our regression model, the simplest approach to fix it would be to remove some of these variables from the regression model. So first I remove size from the model. Now we can see that coefficient for ROA has a positive sign and statistically significant. Look, small alteration to the model has substantially altered the coefficient for ROA. Anyway, multicollinearity problem is still there as indicated by these high VIF values. And now let's remove ROE from the model and put size back into the model. Now we can see that the coefficient for ROA is almost equal to 0 and statistically not significant. This time also, small alteration in the model has caused a substantial alteration in the coefficient for ROA. This is one of the problems when we have multicollinearity in the model. We cannot rely on the coefficients estimated by the regression. Anyway, multicollinearity problem is still there as indicated by these VIF values. Okay, let's remove both ROE and size this time and keep only ROA. I do not want to remove ROA because I think it is a good measure of firm performance and I am not seriously worried about removing ROE. Now, among the three variables with high VIF values, I remove 2 so that I have only 1 in the regression model now. Then I click OK. Now we can see that Durbin and Watson statistic is OK, model is statistically significant, residuals are normally distributed, all VIF values are below 5, indicating the absence of multicollinearity issues. This implies that our results are reliable this time. Here we can see that both coefficients are statistically significant and have expected signs as well. As mentioned earlier, if our regression results are reliable, these estimated coefficients should remain unchanged even if we add or remove other independent variables into the model. So let's see what happens if I add one more independent variable into our model. This time I am going to add exchange rate into our model. Everything still looks good. All VIF values are below 5. And see here, even when I change the model by adding another variable, the coefficient for ROA and leverage has not been changed. This indicates that these estimates are reliable. For further verification, let's keep only ROA in the model this time. See, even when we change the model by dropping all other independent variables, the coefficient for ROA has not been changed. So in conclusion, when we do not have multicollinearity issues in our model, regression results become more stable and reliable. Nevertheless, there are other approaches to deal with multicollinearity issues, but I do not intend to discuss them here.